so that other people can watch it later on. But we are going to go ahead and get started. Today's topic is October staples, playful pumpkins and gainful garlic. My name is Anthony Reardon. I am the horticulture small farms agent for Johnson County. Also joining us today is Chelsea Reinberg. She is our FCS agent that deals with health and nutrition, and she will introduce herself in a bit when it's time for her portion. So getting started here, let's see, my computer needs to work with me. We're going to first dive into pumpkins. So a lot of this information has come directly from the Kansas Garden Guide. It's brand new, newly refurbished this year. I think I've plugged this 60 times in these and we've only had three classes so far. So yes, this is a very good publication. There's lots of great information in it. A little terminology to cover before we get into, the nitty gritty of pumpkins is just, knowing what people are referring to and we refer to these different terms. So pumpkins are anything that is round or an orange gourd. So, the typical what you would assume is a pumpkin, it's got that round shape to it and it's got that signature color to it. Squash, those are going to be edible fruits of other shapes or colors, and then gourds themselves are various shapes and sizes. The fruit themselves are more so used as a decoration. All of them are in the cucurbit family, and they can be cross-pollinated, which means that if you have a cucumber plant growing right next to it, or if you have different varieties growing right next to it, you can get some very gnarly different types of gourds from that pollination. But this is really only going to affect the seeds that come from those fruits. So if you're not saving the seeds to then reuse for next season, it doesn't really matter. So pumpkins, let's look at some general conditions that pumpkins grow in. They are a warm season plant, which means that they are usually sown in the summer months. You can actually get by sowing these as soon as after the first frost of the year. You want to plant these directly into the ground. And the thing with pumpkins is that their roots are very, very sensitive. So if you were to try to put these in pots and then transplant them to the ground, it's not that they won't be successful, but it's going to be a lot less successful because the roots do not like being disturbed whatsoever. They can also really not acclimate very well from different conditions very quickly. So it's really best just to sow them directly into the ground. If you are aiming for an October harvest with pumpkins, which a lot of people, tend to do because the pumpkin is kind of the signature crop of October, then you actually want to plant them in June. And that's because it takes 75 to 100 days from sowing to the fully developed fruit. So if that fruit is, planted sooner than that, you may be actually looking at a September harvest rather than an October. Choosing varieties to grow can be based on many different decisions. There's going to be many different sizes of pumpkins, which we'll talk about in a second, but also there's decorative pumpkins, there's cooking pumpkins. There's many different reasons to choose the particular variety you're going to go with. So looking at some of the different options that you have with pumpkins, there's four main categories of sizes. So there's the very small ornamental sizes. These would be 8 to 10 pounds or less. Your medium-sized pumpkins, these are more so going to be like your pie pumpkins, the ones that get used for culinary purposes. These will be 10 to 25 pounds. Your larger pumpkins of greater than 25 pounds are typically your jack-o'-lantern types that will be used for decoration. And then your jumbo pumpkins, which actually can be up to 2,000 pounds. These are typically grown, as novelty items or for, fairs to kind of just show off. Typically, there's a lot of special maintenance that has to go into them. As you can see in this photo, this pumpkin had to be grown on top of a pallet because a tractor eventually had to move it, right? Because you're not going to be able to lift a 2,000-pound pumpkin. So there's lots of different considerations to take into account with the different varieties. So when it comes to soil for pumpkins, They are best grown in areas with no perennial weed problems and good drainage. And this is because the weeds are going to act as competitors for your nutrients, right? They're going to compete for your soil nutrients. They're going to compete for sun. They're going to compete for light. Well, I guess sun and light are the same thing. They're going to compete for your water. Aside from that, they're also going to act as a pest hotel. So any, pesticides that you may happen to use on your plants, if you're not also treating the weeds that are right next to it, those pests can hide in those weeds and then they can go right back to your plants. So that treatment may not be as effective. The ideal pH for pumpkins is going to be in the acidic range of 6.0 to 6.5. So a soil test to know the pH is really going to help you out. It's going to help you know if you need to supply sulfur to it to lower that pH. Supplemental nitrogen will be necessary because these fruits are so big. The plants themselves are so big. The vines can get up to 12, 20 feet long. That is going to require a lot of nitrogen in order for the plant itself to grow and actually get to size. You want to use a soil test to know the recommended amount of phosphorus and potassium to add as well. And again, that's just because these are your main macronutrients. So if something's deficient, you need to be supplementing those. Long rotations of 3 to 4 years are recommended for an area. So what that means is there are a lot of pests and diseases that are associated with pumpkins, and they can overwinter in the ground. So you don't want to have your pumpkin patch in the same spot year after year, because if they are overwintering in the grounds, it's likely that they're going to be on next year's crop. And that's just going to be reintroducing the same problem without solving it. When it comes to spacing pumpkins, again, you need to keep in mind that they're huge plants, right? So vines need 50 to 60 square feet per the hill they are growing on. In 12-foot rows, you can put 1 to 2 plants every 4 to 5 feet. With small and semi-vining varieties, you can actually plant them a bit closer, and that can be every 3 to 4 feet. Seeds should be planted at a 1-inch depth, so they don't have to be too deep, but that 1-inch depth is going to be ideal for germination. And then small and semi-vining types can actually be planted in your 4-foot to 5-foot, they can be planted in 6-foot rows, 4 feet to 5 feet apart. And again, that's because they require less space. So when it comes to cultivating, this is something that's typically, required with any kind of vegetable, maintenance. And that's just because it's going to impede any weed growth. You want to be very careful with it because, again, the roots are highly sensitive. So you're just barely scratching the top of the ground. You don't want to disturb these roots. And the thing with these roots is they're also growing very shallow. So they're going to be right at the top of the surface. So you want to scratch the surface enough to get the stems of the weeds severed, essentially. And then you want to leave the soil alone. Cultivation is still necessary, however, to prevent weed competition. And it's going to be more difficult to prevent that weed growth or competition as the plants get bigger, right? Because as these plants take up a massive amount of space, they're going to essentially be hiding underneath the pumpkins when the weeds are growing. And the use of straw can be very effective with preventing those weeds as well. So when it comes to watering, you again want to remember that these are huge plants. So huge plants need lots of water. The general recommendation when it comes to any kind of watering is always you want moist soil, but you don't want it sopping wet. So if you can take a handful of soil and literally squeeze water out of it, that's too much. It needs to be well draining generally, but still have it moist. Pumpkins should be watered thoroughly as the fruit begins to develop, because that is when it's going to be most important. And then that consistent moisture should be kept throughout the season. And then a minimum of 1 inch of water per week is really what's required. If it's drought conditions or if it's really hot outside, you're going to want to add more. So In addition to being shallow rooted, the roots do go deep as well. So that means that it's basically that whole profile that the pumpkins are growing in. They're taking it up, right? They're not in one spot or the other. So limited water will be okay once the pumpkins are established, because they will reach down and still reach that water. Other critical periods for watering are going to be late July to early August. And that's really because that's when the fruit's going to really start to set. And when it's blooming and it's early fruit set is also going to be important. So, you know, all those blooms will eventually equate to your fruit. And so that those flowers need to be supported so they don't just fall off and die before the fruit can set. Speaking of blooming and pollination, one of the things you have to keep in mind with pumpkins is they have both male flowers and female flowers. The male flowers will have the pollen, the female flowers will have the seed. Typically, there's going to be more male flowers than female flowers. You're going to have 2 to 3 male flowers to every 1 female flower. Because of this, the bees are absolutely necessary. They must transfer the pollen from the male flower to the female flower for a fruit to form and grow. This can actually be tricky, though, because the flowers close at the end of the day. They are only open for a certain time period during the day. So it's really important to encourage pollinators into your area in order to ensure that pollination. And if you can't ensure that pollination, you may have to take like a paintbrush or something along those lines and do it yourself. Powdery mildew is one of the more common issues when it comes to, or disease issues when it comes to pumpkin plants. And you can actually have up to a 30% yield loss if you don't take care of this. It's a fungal disease, so really it's not something that's hard to take care of, but you do need to stay on top of it. Late July through early August is when it begins to appear. And this is when you should apply azoxystrobin, trifloxystrobin, pyroclostrobin, or this other one that I'm not going to attempt to pronounce, but these are your options. It doesn't affect the fruit, but it does affect the rest of the plant. So remember, that's removing shade and it's removing the sustenance that's forming from the leaves. Those leaves are your photosynthetizing portions of the plant that are literally making the food for the plant itself. So if you're removing the food makers for the plants, it's not going to be healthy. And then that in effect is going to affect the fruit. Squash bugs are a huge issue with pumpkins. It's probably the most prominent issue. The thing with squash bugs is you have to be very attentive to their growth stage in order to treat them. They have to be treated during their nymph stage, which is shown up top. And that's because they don't have these armory coats that you see down on the bottom yet. If you're trying to use one of these insecticides while it has these armory coats, they're likely not going to be affected because it's literally a coat of armor, right? So when they're still soft in their nymph stage, that's when you want to try to apply either your permethrin, your bifenthrin, or your pyrethrins. Something to keep in mind with all these is they're stronger insecticides, so you are going to want to try to protect your pollinators when you're doing this. Remember, pollinators are very important when it comes to pumpkins. So the best time to apply would be early morning or late evening, because that is when the pollinators are going to be stationary. They're not going to be flying around. Essentially, they're going to be in bed, right? So that's the safer time to be applying those chemicals for the pollinators. When it comes to harvesting pumpkins, it's pretty simple. You need to watch the stems. When they fully dry out and lose their succulence and there's no more softness to them, that's when the pumpkin is ready to be harvested. Also, you can do a fingernail test with a rind, kind of just an inconspicuous spot. If you can still puncture the rind with your fingernail, it's not quite done yet, right? And then when you are removing these from the vine, just a sharp pair of pruners is best for that sever. And these can stay outside in most frost conditions, but if it's going to be a hard freeze where it's your low to mid 20s, this is when you want to definitely at least harvest them, if not take them inside, because that's when you're going to start getting that cellular damage with the fruits because it's going to freeze that hard. And now we'll go into garlic. Most of the information I have gotten from the or for the garlic that you will see in these slides is actually from this great publication from Sedgwick County, written by Rebecca McMahon. But we do have a ton of information on garlic as well on our Johnson County website. So there's lots of good publications out there, and K-State has a plethora of information for you. So there are two main types of garlic that you are going to be growing in your garden. There's softneck. This is the one that is usually found in grocery stores, and it actually doesn't grow that well in Kansas. It doesn't like the soil here, and it doesn't like the environmental conditions that it's growing in. Hardneck grows well here, and these ones are different in that they have flowers / scapes, and that's important. We'll talk about that in a bit. But also the difference that you'll notice is that the flavors vary greatly by the variety. So these can be all the way on the mild side of a flavor to actually the very spicy garlic. When it comes to soil for garlic, you have to keep in mind this is a bulb. So a fertile sandy loam is actually what's best and what's recommended. And that's because it's going to drain that water out of there quickly. And it's not going to, essentially encourage bulb rot. If you have water sitting there for too long, that's going to encourage rot. And then your plant's not going to be successful, obviously. A slightly acidic pH of 6.3 to 6.8 is recommended. And then tilling your soil is also recommended because looser soil, put simply, is going to equate to your bulbs having the capacity to grow larger because they don't have that pressure against them to not grow larger. And then amend with soil test recommendations, as we have mentioned before. Phosphorus is a key nutrient that aids in cell division and flower development. And keep in mind that a lot of your hardneck varieties, they produce those scapes / flowers, which ultimately we're going to remove because we don't want them on the plants. But for that bulb to fully develop, or those cloves on that bulb to fully develop, you actually want to encourage the flower initially. So when it comes to planting, garlic is planted in October, and that is because we still have warm soil that is a remnant of the summer, right? It hasn't quite cooled down yet with the cold weather. Also in October, it's typically moist outside. Again, that's going to depend on the weather a bit, but typically our autumn conditions are going to be a little bit more wet. And then the air itself is cool, so it's not going to be cooking the plants as it's trying to establish in the ground. Spring planting is possible with garlic, but it's not going to be as successful. So really right now is the best, most recommended time. It kind of falls along the lines of, your spring bulbs that you would plant in an ornamental setting, like your tulips or something along those lines. It needs the long periods of cold throughout the winter in order to establish well. Rotating your plants from the location of last year's crop is also recommended. It is with most crops, right? But again, that's just going to be because your diseases and your pests can overwinter in the soil. And then to plants itself, you want to break up your bulbs into the individual cloves. You just take the root side and you plant it root side down with the narrow side pointing upward. You want to try to keep the paper skins on there because that's going to protect the bulb as it establishes. And generally, the rule of thumb here is that 1 pound of cloves is going to give you 30 feet of row. Also to keep in mind when you are planting, larger cloves are going to equate to larger bulbs usually. So if you've got a giant clove in there in your bunch, expect a decent sized plant from that. Spacing these, they want to be 2 inches deep underneath the soil. They want to be 6 inches apart from each other. And then the rows should be spaced 1 foot apart. Raised beds, you can plant them a little bit closer. The rows should be 6 to 8 inches apart. And then as with any bulbs, you want to water them in thoroughly, still maintaining that draining soil. And then mulch with straw over it so that moisture can be kept into the soil. So when it comes to spring care of your bulbs, this is after they've overwintered, you want to remove the mulch that's on top because it's going to effectively, help warm up the soil and encourage that bulb growth. Fertilize with a balanced fertilizer or a compost. Again, this is just going to provide the necessary nutrients. And then keep the area weed free again, because these are going to compete with nutrients, and those weeds can act as pest hotels. These also have shallow roots, so you want to be careful when it comes to cultivating or messing with the soil. And then again, keep the soil moist but not saturated, because bulb rot can still happen. As I just mentioned, bulb rot is probably your biggest factor that you're going to encounter disease-wise with garlic. And there's actually numerous underlying factors that cause bulb rot. It can be a fungal infection, in which case you may be able to use the fungicide. But if it's to a point where the bulb's already rotting, it's kind of pointless, because you're not getting the crop. Bacterial infections, there's no cure to. So the recommendation is to get it out of the ground, dispose of that crop, and then sterilize the soil. And then inhospitable soil conditions are another condition that can cause bulb rot. So if you have a high clay soil that's retaining a ton of water, again, that's not going to be great for that plant. Thrips are actually the most common pests that you're going to encounter when it comes to garlic. The way these pests operate is they siphon sap from the plant. Typically, it's going to cause a blotching or a discoloration on the leaves, but in very severe infestations, it can kill entire stands of the plants. So spinosad is the recommended insecticide. And again, this is one of your harsher chemicals, so you want to take those steps to protect your pollinators and only apply it in the early morning or in the evening. So as I mentioned, these plants, or the hardneck varieties, do produce garlic scapes, which is essentially the flower before it's flowered. It's the flower stalk. The thing with these is they can actually make your bulbs up to 30% smaller if you let them produce a flower. So they want to be removed when they are still somewhat in their soft stage before it's woody. And if you do happen to snap these off, when they are in their soft stage, they have culinary purposes. You can use them in stir fries or as green onions or scallions. They just kind of have a garlicky flavor to them because they're garlic. And then when it comes to harvesting, most varieties are going to be ready in mid-June to mid-July. Your best indicator is when the 5 outermost leaves are dried up. When you have 3 to 4 outermost leaves dried, that's your indicator that it's time to stop watering and to let the plant go dormant. You want to dig up the whole plant with a garden fork. And then when you're drying them, you actually want to hold off on actually brushing them off or anything for at least a day. Then after that day has passed, you can hang the bulbs up in a well-ventilated shady spot for up to 2 to 3 weeks for proper drying. And this will enable longer storage and usage. And then when it comes to actual storage, after drying them, you can clip the roots all the way back to the bulb itself. And you want to trim the canes so that there's still 1 inch of neck on there. And that's just to keep all the moisture within the bulb itself. You can store them in mesh bags in a cool, dry area. The ideal conditions are 50 degrees Fahrenheit and less than 60 degrees or 60% humidity. And then for longer storage, you can actually put these in the vegetable drawer in your refrigerator, and they can keep from all the way from June to March, potentially. So before we hand over to Chelsea, are there any quick questions that anyone would like answered about the growing aspects of these? All right. Well, if that's the case, I am going to hand over to Chelsea.
Awesome. Thank you. Okay. So I'm going to talk about the nutrition and some preparation ideas for pumpkins and garlic. As Anthony mentioned before, I am the nutrition, food safety, and health agent here in the office, and I'm a registered dietitian and cover all things related to nutrition, food safety, and health. Next slide.
Oops, wrong way.
Nope, that was right.
Okay.
So pumpkins are more than just for carving. Typically when you think about pumpkins, it's everyone wants their pumpkin to carve their favorite jack-o'-lantern, which of course is a purpose of pumpkins. As Anthony covered, there are some different varieties. So you have the jack-o'-lantern, which is best for carving. The pie pumpkins are those smaller ones, and they're best for cooking. And then, of course, there's miniature orange and white ones, which are best for just the decoration piece. The variety of pumpkin that is actually most typically canned looks actually more similar to a butternut squash than a jack-o'-lantern. So when you buy the pumpkin pie in the store, the pumpkin, the pureed pumpkin in the grocery store in the can, it's not going to be your jack-o'-lantern type style pumpkin that is being processed and put in there. It's actually going to look a little bit more similar to a butternut squash than your typical pumpkin that you think of. And technically, as Anthony covered, it is a fruit, but in terms of nutrition, we treat it more like a vegetable. So a pumpkin will be counted as more of a vegetable versus a fruit when we are thinking about where we are at in consuming our fruits and vegetables for the day. Next slide. So the nutrition, 1 cup of canned pumpkin puree is pretty low in calorie. Where a lot of the calories come from in pumpkin is our high fat desserts. You know, we think of our pumpkin pies and all those other tasty things. But in terms of the pumpkin itself, it is a fairly low calorie food. It has about 3 grams of protein and 20 grams of carbohydrates. Pureed pumpkin is going to be a natural sugar. And so it has some, but the other great thing about canned pumpkin is the amount of fiber that is in it. So 1 cup has about 7 grams of fiber. The recommended intake for your daily fiber is about 25 grams to 31 grams, depending on your age and if you're male or female. So you are well on your way to meeting your goals if you have just 1 cup of canned pumpkin. Pumpkin is a very nutrient-dense food, and so what nutrient-dense means is that it is loaded with vitamins and minerals, and it is low in saturated fat, low in added sugar, and low in salt. So this, as you can see, meets that mark. The other two vitamins and minerals that I want to point out in pumpkin specifically is the potassium. And so pumpkins are rich in potassium. About 10% of your recommended intake is in a half a cup. And so if you have 1 cup, you'd be at about 20% of your recommended intake. Potassium, if we think of, is commonly found in bananas as well. It is great for our heart health, and it has a lot of other related factors. It helps with your blood pressure regulation, electrolytes, all those good things. So getting your potassium is a great source from our pumpkins here. And then the other thing is our vitamin A. And so vitamin A is good for our eyesight typically, but it also is great for our immune system and helps with a lot of other functions within our body. So 1 cup of pumpkin has 250% of our recommended daily amount of vitamin A, which is great. And so typically we aren't sufficient. We get enough vitamin A in our diet, but this is also another great source. If you feel like you are lacking a little bit of vitamin A, you don't eat many other orange colored fruits or vegetables, going to your canned pumpkin is going to be a great source of vitamin A. Next slide. So the health benefits. Again, you may wonder why pumpkins are so vibrantly orange. Well, it is due to their beta carotene. And so our bodies convert that beta carotene into vitamin A, which is what is helpful for us. So our body does go through a process to use that beta carotene and turn it into something that is beneficial for us. As I mentioned before, fiber is also very, very prominent in our pureed pumpkin. We've talked about fiber in previous Dig Your Dinner series, but a fiber is great for beneficially removing cholesterol from the body. It helps keeps our blood sugars stable from spiking, and it helps us regulate our bowels. So in addition to that, fiber also helps us feel fuller longer. So fiber is a great benefit to add to our diet. Most Americans do not get enough fiber. We get about 10 to 15 grams of fiber is all. And so having pumpkin as a fiber source is a great option. And then potassium. Almost 1/3 of Americans have high blood pressure. Eating pumpkin may decrease your blood pressure and help control your blood pressure. Potassium also is another beneficial nutrient for bone health and decreases your risk for diabetes. So as I mentioned on the previous slide, potassium is a very common and prominent source in pumpkins as well. Next slide. The other benefit, the other micronutrient that is in pumpkins that I'm going to talk about is magnesium. Magnesium is great for helping lower your blood pressure and again, helps maintain that good bone health. About 50% of Americans do not get enough magnesium in their diet. So not specifically found in a high prevalence in the flesh of the pumpkin, but it is found most commonly in the pumpkin seeds themselves, which we're going to talk about in the next couple slides. But these were just a few of the main nutrients and their health benefits that are found in pumpkins. Of course, there are many, as with any vitamin or any fruit and vegetable, there is going to be a variety of vitamins and minerals in each of them, but these were the key ones to highlight in pumpkins. One thing to remember is that you do not get the same health benefits from pumpkin flavored foods and drinks. You can still enjoy your pumpkin spice lattes for all the caffeine and your pumpkin spice flavored foods, but those really are just the flavorings. They have no nutritional benefit as what you get by eating your pumpkin as a whole vegetable. Next slide. So don't forget the pumpkin seeds. Don't toss those out, especially if you are carving your jack-o'-lanterns. You may not be eating the flesh of your jack-o'-lantern pumpkin, but you can definitely keep those seeds. And those seeds are going to be rich in that magnesium, as I mentioned before. They are small, but they are mighty and pack a mighty punch when it comes to nutrition, as in most seeds and nuts do. They have the magnesium. They're a great source of zinc and fiber. So adding those to your dishes and eating as a snack is a great option. According to the American Heart Association, only about 1/4 of a cup of pumpkin seed. And so 1/4 of a cup is really like the center of your palm. So if we think about the fleshy piece there of your hand, that would be about 1/4 of a cup. Of that, that provides almost half of our daily recommended amount of magnesium. So popping just a handful of pumpkin seeds daily will help you make your magnesium goals and to keep your heart and your body healthy. If you are buying pre-paired, already cooked pumpkin seeds from the store, make sure that you just watch the added salt. Try to choose pumpkin seeds that have no salt added or that are lower in salt and sodium. That is an important thing that is typically added during the processing when it is packaged on your shelves. So just be cautious of that. Next slide. So how do you cook your pumpkin seeds? You may be wondering that if you've never made your own pumpkin seeds in the oven before. So as you're carving your pumpkins, go ahead and take out those pumpkin seeds with the flesh that's going to come out with the stringy flesh. And you're going to separate out your seeds from that flesh. And so part of that is going to be a little bit of a process of rinsing it. You can use a colander to help strain out that water. And you'll want to just separate them out. So once you have all the flesh removed, you're going to wash your pumpkin seeds to remove any of that remaining tissue. And then you're going to place your pumpkin seeds in a dehydrator for about 1 to 2 hours or in an oven that's on warm for about 3 to 4 hours. And so you're going to stir that frequently. That's going to help to just dry them out a little bit more before we actually then roast them and add some seasonings to them. So you want to make sure you do that first. It does really help to make the texture and the quality a little bit better. You can, of course, just kind of add the seasonings right in the beginning and toast them in the oven that way, but it's not going to have quite the same result. So once you dry them and get them to a nice crunchy texture, the second piece is to roast them. So you're going to toss your pumpkin seeds with an olive oil or an avocado oil, and then you're going to add your favorite seasonings. You can add some salt, pepper, garlic, or cumin, and then you're going to roast them in the oven for about 10 to 15 minutes. Again, just constantly stirring to make sure that you avoid scorching them and burning them. And then you're going to let them cool. And then once they're cooled, you will store them in an airtight container at room temperature and munch away on them as snacks or tossed into salads. Next slide. So you can also use pumpkin as a substitute in cooking. This is pretty common for people who want to reduce specifically the butter that is found in baking items. So when you are looking for a substitution, we have a couple options here. If your recipe calls for oil, your pumpkin puree substitute is going to be a 1-to-1 ratio. So if it calls for 1 cup of oil, you're going to use 1 cup of pumpkin puree. If it calls for butter, you're going to have a little bit different of a ratio. If it calls, let's say, for 1 cup of butter, you are going to use 3/4 cup of pumpkin puree. So the ratio is about 3/4. And then you can also substitute a pumpkin puree for an egg in a recipe. And so if it calls for 1 large egg, you'll do about 1/2 cup of pumpkin puree. The substitutions may change the texture of the product. Of course, oil and butter has a purpose in recipes, and so the texture may be changed. Therefore, you should just really start with one substitution at a time. Or if you want to experiment, you hopefully can find the sweet spot with using pumpkin in your baked goods. Sometimes it is an experimentation process, and maybe you don't want to do an exact one-to-one ratio. Maybe your recipe calls for 1 cup of oil, use a half a cup of oil, and then you would use a half a cup of pumpkin puree. And that will help to cut some of those calories out while keeping the moisture and the texture of the baked dessert, whatever you are making. Next slide. So when we typically think of pumpkin, we think of all the sweet dishes, our pumpkin pies and pumpkin breads, muffins, all those things. But pumpkin actually goes really well with savory dishes as well. Having it as a soup by itself or pouring some into a pot of chili as you're making it adds a nice depth and a nice just creaminess to your chili. It can also be made in pasta sauces using a pumpkin pasta sauce over top of your salsa, over top of your pasta, creates like a nice cheesy pasta type consistency and flavor. And then of course, as I mentioned, your pumpkin seeds, don't forget about them. You can add those to salads and dishes to make for a nice little crunch, or you can just eat those as a plain snack. Next slide. So here's just a recipe for an idea talking about the savory piece. This is a pumpkin black bean soup. So you're using black beans and canned tomatoes, some spices, and then you're using a can of pumpkin. Just a disclaimer, this picture is not the exact recipe. So you, when you make it, it may not look exactly the same, but this is a very tasty version of using a black bean soup with just a little bit extra kick from that pumpkin, adding a little bit more nutrients and fiber. Next slide. So now moving on to garlic. You know, the common thing that people think of with garlic is your garlic breath. And is it worth it? The short answer is yes. Most of garlic's health benefits are due to the formation of the sulfur compounds when you chop, crush, or chew a garlic clove. And so even though garlic gives you bad breath when you eat it and you use it in culinary purposes, there is some health benefits to it, which some people may not forget or may not realize because it is a quite small little ingredient in most recipes. Next slide. So the nutrition, you know, there is not much nutrition when we think of calories, fat, fiber, all of those things. It's more of a seasoning and additive, but it has a lot of great vitamins and minerals. So garlic contains potassium, phosphorus, manganese, sulfur, vitamin B6, vitamin C, and selenium, which are all very important and have functions within our body. And then also contains something called phytonutrients. And phytonutrients are what help prevent certain diseases like cancer, heart disease, and diabetes. Next slide. So health benefits. Garlic was believed to have medicinal purposes thousands of years ago. We are just now starting to have some of that scientific evidence to back that theory up. We hear of garlic being used in Chinese medicine and other things, and now we are having some of that evidence. So studies have shown that there is health promoting and disease preventing effects on humans with common diseases such as cancer, cardiovascular and metabolic disorders, even blood pressure and diabetes. And that's because of those phytonutrients, which are antioxidants. Garlic is known as an anti-inflammatory, and it also has lipid-lowering properties. Garlic may, that is raw, may retain some more of that beneficial compounds than cooked. So that is one thing that eating a raw garlic, which we'll talk about the different forms of raw garlic that you can eat, may have some more of those nutritional benefits, but the amount, there's really not a specific number. And so again, just encourage to eat garlic in whatever way you like. And then a 2020 meta-analysis of studies found that garlic supplements reduce blood pressure in people with high blood pressure. So again, supplements are a little bit different, but it just does go to show that there is some correlation between the principles of garlic and what the compounds in them and the health effect of on our cardiovascular health. Next slide. The main compound in garlic that gives it its great potent health potential is something called allicin. A 2019 review showed that allicin and garlic may limit the production of angiotensin II, which is a hormone that increases your blood pressure. So having a lower angiotensin II means that your blood pressure will be lower. And then also helps relax your blood vessels, which allows your blood to flow more freely, thus reducing your blood pressure. Studies show that roasting, boiling, heating, or pickling garlic can significantly reduce that allicin content. So it's a process that transfers it to a different compound, and it isn't quite as potent as that allicin is. And then the other thing with garlic is it has antibacterial properties. And so that just is kind of another health benefit that has been shown to be in the allicin of garlic. Next slide. There is two things to be cautious of. If you currently have GERD or gastroesophageal reflux disease, you should not consume or at least limit your garlic. Garlic has been known to be a trigger for those that have GERD and can make your reflux even worse. So if you have that, you need to be cautious of the amount that you're consuming or just limit it completely. And then the second thing is, if you are on blood thinner, garlic can increase the risk of bleeding, which prevents formation of blood clotting. So you should talk to your doctor before you start to increase the amount of garlic you're consuming on a daily basis. Next slide. So with garlic, there is a couple ways you can adjust the flavor intensity. So if you have a whole garlic clove, there's going to be really no odor. You may notice that when you get it, you don't smell anything until you start to cut that open. The flavor is produced of garlic when the cells are damaged. And the important thing to remember with this is the smaller you cut your garlic, the stronger your flavor. So here's kind of an example. If you are wanting just a mild garlic flavor, whole roasted or sliced garlic is going to be your most mild flavor. If you want a more fuller garlic flavor, going ahead and chopping it is going to be your best bet. And that's just going to be with a knife. If you want a more intense flavor, you're going to crush it. And then your most intense is going to be pressed, minced, or grated. So maybe you use a garlic press all the time and the garlic is just too intense for you. Maybe you try to chop that garlic instead in your recipes. Or if you're wanting something just more mild to eat garlic, just plain or on a piece of bread, roasting it in the oven as a whole garlic is going to be your best option because that's going to have the least intense flavor. Next slide. Some people think that they want to make their own infused garlic oil because, again, garlic has great flavor and it goes well in a lot of dishes. However, there is word of caution with this. So garlic, vegetable, herbs, and oil mixtures may support the growth of Clostridium botulinum, which is basically botulism. And so for safety reasons, they should only be made fresh and leftovers should be refrigerated or used within 3 days, frozen or discarded. So you do not want to make a oil-infused mixture with garlic and let it set for 2 months because there is an increased risk of botulism. Researchers at the University of Idaho have developed guidelines for infusing oils with garlic, basil, oregano, and rosemary. And there is a publication from the Pacific Northwest Extension about making them that provides detailed information on this process. So if you are interested, go ahead and go check that out. But again, the best recommendation is to make sure that you are using it within a few days and discard any oil that you have not used in your cooking. Next. So ways to enjoy garlic. It's typically enjoyed raw or cooked. And so raw garlic, it's a little bit stronger. It's often added to your dips, dressings, and sauces. And again, as I mentioned in my previous slides, raw garlic is going to have the most allicin, which is where that health benefit comes from. So if you're looking to get kind of a strong kick from that health benefit and getting all the potential benefits of allicin, using it in your dips and dressings in a raw form is going to be the best. When you cook it, it does change the taste and texture, making it a little bit softer, milder, and creamier, and it gives it a more subtle flavor and aroma. And so this is typically used when you are cooking it within dishes, that you want kind of just a slight undertone of that garlic, but you don't want that sort of raw garlic, strong, intense flavor. So these are the two ways that you cook it. Again, with the oils and the preservation, we want to be careful of that because it can lead to a growth of botulism if it is stored for too long. Next slide. And so here's an example of using raw garlic. So this has... The I also just realized that I think the recipe is wrong. So I'll need to change that. The directions are wrong. But this has your garlic and then cannellini beans. And so it's just basically a raw dip. You blend it all together and you can puree it and serve it with crackers, bread, with vegetables, whatever sounds appealing to mix it with. This gives you that raw garlic. It gives you the nice strong flavor. And then it also gives you the health and nutrition benefits. Next slide. And with that, that is the end of kind of the nutrition overview. As I mentioned on previous ones, we do have a monthly e-newsletter that goes out. If you're interested for recipes or more information, you can sign up for that there. And if there's any questions, feel free to type them in the chat or to unmute yourself. All right. If there's any questions that come up after the fact, you can always contact us via our contact information that was shared on the slides or by calling our office. And we look forward to connecting with you again next time.